the best response you can have to a payoff in a thriller is someone goes, oh, right, I forgot, of course, I should have.
On Story offers a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers, creators, and filmmakers. All of our content is recorded live at Austin Film Festival and our year-round events. To view previous episodes, visit onstory.tv. On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. From Austin Film Festival, this is On Story, a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers, creators, and filmmakers. This week's On Story, the writer-director behind Nightcrawler and Roman J. Israel Esquire, Dan Gilroy.
10 years ago, I found my voice. Odd to say, but I think many of us don't know exactly what our voice is. And when you find your voice, suddenly everything starts to become a lot easier. It's ideas start filtering in a different way. Your approach starts going a different way. I just realized what it was that I wanted to do.
In this episode, Dan Gilroy discusses the evolution of the Academy Award-nominated Nightcrawler and working with Denzel Washington to create an unforgettable idealist in the critically acclaimed Roman J. Israel Esquire.
Get a shot on the other side.
Right.
Get a shot inside the car! Go around, get inside the car, that's what I'm paying you for!
Hey, that's great. Get back, loader. Get back!
I'm back.
I started screenwriting when I was 18 and wrote, between 18 and 28, wrote 10 really bad screenplays. I never went to film school. I had 9-to-5 jobs. I sold my first one at 29 or 30 for $5,000 and sort of climbed my up the ladder. Anyway, building up a wide Nightcrawler. So for 22, 24 years, I was a working screenwriter in Hollywood. I say working in the sense that I was getting paid most of the time, but very few of my films were getting made. Anyway, started getting some films made. I was doing production rewriting, spending a lot of time on sets. And the films that then started getting made, they were not getting made the way I wanted them to get made. Not the director doing a bad job. The directors had a vision for how they saw the script, and it was utterly legitimate. You can say film is a director's medium. I don't believe that. I believe it's a writer's medium, and we can talk more about that. But it's a director's medium to a degree, but it all starts with a blank page. I decided I wanted, my brother Tony and I are going side by side. We're both working. He does Michael Clayton, and he makes this jump. And I watched it, and I thought, well, that's something I'd like to do, but I really do respect the chair. I do respect directing, and it requires many skills, some of them which I didn't have. So I really started to study cinematography and spending more time on sets, and I finally decided I was going to write a script to direct. Nightcrawler was an idea that I'd had for 15 years, and we could talk about the evolution of that, but I finally cracked it. The key ultimately was coming up with an anti-hero. And here's my formula. My formula is write, if it's your first one, write something cheap. So I thought that my original budget for it was like, I thought I could do this for like $4 million. I thought. And then I very much agree with Bill Goldman's adage, stars get movies made. Bill has many adages that people know, but one of Bill Goldman's many adages is really, stars get movies made, or elements get movies made. So I had Nightcrawler, and I knew I was a first-time director, and people don't want to give you your first directing gig, but if you have a script and it's good and you say I'm directing, it's really rather remarkable. People go, okay, you're the director. you know, at least until you have, as you're raising the money. So I took the script, I went around and got the finance guy, Jake. Jake was interested in doing it. I wrote a part, I thought it was a star part and a way to attract somebody. And I did that with Roman Israel, same thing. And when Jake committed, it happened then very quickly after that. I'm at a point in my life now where I want my films to have something reflecting what I believe in or my view of the world. And Nightcrawler is a very personal film for me. It's ultimately about hypercapitalization and what happens when the law of the jungle becomes the law of the land and the lose of the world wind up winning. It's very much a cautionary tale. And I really only see myself making films now that are both entertaining and also have some reflection of my voice.
You'll take me around, you'll introduce me as the owner and president of Video Production News and remind them of some of my many other stories. I'm not done. I also want to stop our discussion over prices. This will save time. So when I say that a particular number is my lowest price, that's my lowest price. And you can be assured that I arrived at whatever that number is very carefully. Now, when I say that I want these things, I mean that I want them. And I don't want to have to ask again. And the last thing that I want, Nina, is for you to do the things that I ask you to do when we're alone together in your apartment. Not like the last time.
So if your plot, essentially, though, is birthed your characters, then in Nightcrawler, when I watched it again, it wasn't because I liked him. It was really because he grossed me out, you know? But there was that bit of having to see him and figure out, what the hell, you know, because you know there are people kind of like that.
So like I said, I spent a long time working in the studio system. I still sort of dip my toe in once in a while. And it's gotten to the point now where the rules are just too onerous to me. It's these meetings are... we need to know more about his backstory. His arc, is the arc clear? Is he nice and likable enough? It's just endless stuff. And the fourth test screening, they didn't understand 2 hours and 4 minutes in what was going on. What do we do about that? And it's like, I got to tell you, after 20 years, it does start to like, it's like Chinese water torture. So when I wrote Nightcrawler, I decided constantly, I'm throwing all that shit out the window. I don't care about the arc. Luke comes in stage left and leaves stage right exactly the same, only with more power. There's no backstory. He's not likable at all. And that felt good. Luke was very much, I wanted to underwrite him. I didn't want any backstory. I didn't want you to know. You could plug anything you wanted for Luke. He'd been in the Navy. He'd been in prison. He'd been abused, whatever you wanted to do. He never gave any backstory. And the other thing was my biggest fear writing Nightcrawler was I did not want it to be a psychopath movie. I appreciate like American Psycho, and I appreciate certain ones, but that's not something I'm really particularly interested in, because I'm interested in a picture where Hitler is playing with like little children and a dog, and people say what a great guy he was. How weird is that? You know, like that's the other side of Hitler. There is another side to these people. And so I was interested in Lou's other side. So writing Lou was very much like he's doing these things, but he's always pleasant, and his shirt is always tucked in, and he's always vaguely reasonable.
Thank you for offering me the position, but working for myself is more in line with my skills and career goals.
Take a few days to think about it.
No, you'll need to hire someone else, and I don't want to hold up the process.
You want to be on the inside of this, man, because I'm going to be tag-teaming every call.
You keep talking like it's something that I may be interested in, but I'm not.
You don't even understand the offer. If you did, you'd be fucking sucking my dick. You're asking me questions. What does this mean? What does that mean?
I feel like grabbing you by your ears right now and screaming in your face, I'm not interested. Instead, I'm going to drive home and do some accounting.
So I'm always looking for that other side, and I think one of the reasons people maybe watch it again is because you're trying to decipher why am I strangely rooting for Lou when he's such a horrible person, because he has a touchstone experience that we can all understand. He just wants to get ahead. It's a tough world, and he's trying to like, so yeah, he's getting, you know, I hope he get, maybe he got it. Why am I rooting for this guy? He's horrible. I'll tell you a bizarre version of Nightcrawler that never got made. It was chaos theory combined with Nightcrawling, and these kids could get to these places before. Why the hell would you use chaos theory for Nightcrawling? Why wouldn't you use it for the stock market? Why wouldn't you use it for anything other than Nightcrawler? As I'm telling it to you, I'm embarrassed to imagine what the executives were thinking while I was desperately pitching this thing. But it got shot down, thank God. And there were other versions, like I said. And then it just wasn't working. Then one day I was like the antihero. And then it just opened up. And the thing about the anti-heroes, then it was like, oh my God, through the anti-hero, I can say all this stuff that I want to say. All the things about society suddenly become clear. All these doors open up. And once you felt that, it's like you want to recreate, then it's like that becomes the yardstick in your future work. You're aiming for that. Roman Israel came from an idea. So he's an activist attorney is what Denzel Washington plays, an activist attorney. And I remember the 1960s. I was young. But on the news and everything, it was just millions of people, it seemed like, were protesting about all these causes of feminism and racial equality and against the war and all these things. Like, everybody's, like, committed. And over the years, it seemed like just everybody sort of drifted away. And I don't judge anybody for doing that. We all have our lives you have to live. But I was very interested in the idea of what if there was somebody, the people who never left. Like, the people who would now be, like, 60 or 65, who never left that period, what would they be like if they'd never given, if they had never changed? So Roman, Denzel's character, came from that. So he became an outsider by virtue of the story, because somebody who never left the field is going to be out of step with his time. And so Denzel's, this is a very different Denzel than you've ever seen him before. He's never played a part like this before. So Denzel is very, very different in this movie. And he is an outsider. And he's mocked. And he's made fun of. And these people dismiss him. And he is an outsider on that level. But it was not a conscious thought to go for that.
If a cop pulls you in and says you can't use the bathroom, then you're being detained.
We're moving on.
What was he supposed to do, Your Honor, pee himself?
You can wait and address this at trial.
Oh, I would like to address it now. I'm just saying we have a real...
Mr. Israel, did you hear what I said?
If armed guards in this courtroom detained you and would not allow you to use the bathroom, you would, by all definition, be detained. I mean, what is good for the goose is good for the gander.
I'm going to hold you in contempt if you continue to pursue this.
With all due respect, you're asking me to obey an erroneous court decision, and you tell me to wait. In my experience, wait.
Okay. Find you in contempt. Is there anything else you'd like to add before I said fine?
I am very interested in characters. Was it AMC has characters live here? That's like their motto or something? I think that's a great motto. Because when I think back to the movies that I love, I remember the characters as much as I remember the movies. Like, I remember, like, the characters. So I'm deeply interested in characters. I saw it as an independent film, in some ways, in terms of its budget. And I took 9 months and I wrote it. And I knew I was writing it for Denzel. I've always wanted to work with Denzel. I've been an enormous fan of Denzel's for a long time. I wrote the part for him. I'd never met him. And I knew if he didn't do it, I wouldn't do the movie. There's nobody else who could have done the part. It was literally written, it's custom fitted for him. And I sent it to him, and it took quite a while for him to read because he was busy. And then I went to New York, and we met, and we had lunch. And over a three-hour lunch, he stuck his hand out and goes, let's make this movie. And that was right before he started Fences. And then I had to wait for a while, and we were deciding where to go. There was a lot of interest in the independent world, and then Sony was interested. So Roman... Like I said, for many years, I've thought about people from the 60s. And there were so many people, and there was this amazing spirit. And there was dark sides of the 60s. There's many people who have written about the tentacles from the 60s that have led down other stuff. It was not all rosy. It was not all phenomenal. But there was this spirit that I was interested in. So that was an idea that I'd had with me for a long time. So the character, I did not think of the character first. That idea was very important. The character formed from that idea. Many of them became progressive lawyers. That was interesting. Then I started thinking about a lawyer. Then I started to think all the versions of the lawyer. He's this firebrand who goes out and fights everything. I just wasn't working, and that wasn't working. And finally, I came up with the idea of a guy who works in the back room. Law firms sometimes have the public person who fights, and then the person in the back room does the work. And then I became interested in taking Denzel and making him the back room guy, the small guy. I like the idea of, there's a great movie called Marty. With Ernest Borgnine. Yeah, Marty's great. And I'll tell you what's interesting about Marty. So that's made at 62. Ernest Borgnine at that point was Hollywood's big heavy. He had done Black Day at Black Rock. He had done The Wild Bunch. And he talks about, like, getting this phone call, like, from Marty. I'm going to play this mama's boy butcher who cries because I didn't have a girlfriend. He couldn't believe they called him. But he won the Academy Award. But it's fascinating because he's playing against type. And I was always interested in... So I started thinking about taking Denzel and playing him against type. So that started to form the character. Like, everything Denzel is, we beat him up in our movie. He's like screaming for help in our movie.
Okay, man, I'm sorry. But I appreciate it, man. Yeah. I know it's late. I appreciate you helping me.
Here's a couple tickets for the mission.
Oh, cool, man. Give me the iPod, man! Give it to me! Come on!
Any money?
Come on!
You got the wrong gun! You got the wrong gun!
That's unusual to see Denzel that way, and people ignore him. So the character became formed partially as a desire to have counter against type for Denzel. It was fascinating to watch. I was more nervous meeting Robert Elswit, the cinematographer, than I was meeting Jake, and I was really nervous meeting Jake. Trying to be, sit down with an actor like Jake and tell him you want to direct. That's a tough meeting. But I was more nervous with Robert Elswit because the hardest thing is the look, the cinematography. Writers don't usually know cinematography. I did not know lenses, composition, aspect ratios, DIs, all this stuff. You have to really learn that. So the look of Nightcrawler came, I had a concept. The concept was that Lou is like a coyote that comes down out of the hills at night to feed. And then he retreats back in the hills. There was a concept. And then I started thinking about, before I met Elswit, this was the concept. I started thinking about the idea that I would have like an animal documentary look. So in animal documentaries, the animals are moving through these really beautiful landscapes often. And the animal sort of is moving through them. So I knew LA was going to look good. I wanted it to be bright. I did not want desaturated LA. I did not want cement and steel LA. I did not want the typical things in LA I did not want typical LA. Often LA is shot desaturated and the sky is yellow and it's like, it's not that. So we were shooting and I wanted to make it look vibrant, wanted to look real. And then Elswit comes in and I give him my shot list and then we show up on the set and what if we moved it over here? And what if we put a 14 on it instead of a 35? And then he started going, yeah, let's do that. And it's like, so honestly, I don't know if any, I mean, maybe some of your directors are photographers and you're really well schooled in this and that's going to serve you well. But for many of us writers who became directors, you're leaning in really hard on your cinematographer. Very hard. But you got to have an idea about it. You know, like if they do start to desaturate or something, you go, that's not what I'm talking about. You know, we're not going there. Roman Israel is a very warm looking film. It's a lot of warmth, a lot of color, a lot of very warm film because it's an emotional film. And for me, this was a concept that I told Robert Erland. I said, Robert, I want it to look warm because to me, emotions live in warmth. So I didn't want it to look blue and hard and cold. This was going to be a warm film. So there's basic guiding concepts that you have for that that were relevant. I never fleshed out any backstory for Lou, and Jake and I never talked about it. One time at 3:00 in the morning, he texted something to me, Lou lives in the desert. And something, and then we never talked about it again. And this same Roman Israel has no backstory. Roman Israel, he tells you he went to college, and he says one other thing about his past, but other than that, you don't know what, before 22, you have no idea where the hell he came from. Because it allows audiences to project, you can engage in the story then. Audiences can they'll fill in the blanks. And partially the reason why Jake and I never talked about it, and Denzel and I never talked about it, is one of the reasons I underwrite is that is that when you do get an actor, it allows them to create. I love actors. I love working with them. I'm not afraid of their questions. I love everything about working with actors. So Jake came in and Denzel came in, and I allowed them very much create the character. Denzel created the character of Roman Israel. Jake created the character of Lou. I wrote him. But it was Jake's idea to do the man bun and the scrunchie and the 27-pound weight loss and all of it. That was Jake. He just came and said, that's what I'm doing. I was saying, great, man. You're creating the character. That's going to be beautiful. Denzel created everything about Roman Israel, the look, the mannerisms, the way of speaking, the everything. And so does not, on that level, I don't need to talk about backstory with my actors. If they want to talk about backstory, I'll talk about it. But I would very much almost be like a therapist at that point. Well, what do you think? What do you think the backstory is? I'm not looking, at a certain point, it is such a collaborative process and I love the collaboration. I very much want, what do you, tell me your idea. That sounds good. And I encourage ideas. Even if I'm a gambler, I like to gamble a lot. And I like to take risks. And things that on the surface seem really strange and scary, I'm usually attracted to. So like when Jake said he wanted to lose weight, like one day, like 6 weeks before shooting, Jake said, I'm going to lose some weight for the part. I'm going, oh, cool, man. That sounds great. I'm going to grow my hair long. He said, great. I don't see him for like 5.5 weeks. We go to do the screen test. Jake's lost 27 pounds and he's got a man bun. And we sat at company 3 for the screen test with my financiers and they lost their, they were like, what the? He has to gain weight and this is going to work. And it all makes sense now. You know, oh yeah, he looks great. Also, it didn't, it was nothing like that. And I'll tell you, that's another thing. Here's a tip. At that point, Jake and I had allied ourselves creatively. We were like lockstep. And the reason one of the reasons I did that, one, because I love Jake and I loved his ideas. But if you lock in with your actor, you form a bond that nobody can break. So even though other people may have wanted to change something, had I been out alone, it was my idea, they could have picked me off. If Jake been out alone, they might have gotten some changes. But because he and I both liked it, they couldn't change any of that stuff. And so I like bonding with the actor. Some directors don't have a connection with their actor. Denzel and I become very close. Jake and I talk regularly. I like actors. I like the process that they go through, the fearlessness of it. I like, it's so fearless what they do, to get up in front of hundreds of people and act that way. And it's very difficult. When I wrote the part of Renee, Renee's a station manager who I saw her when I wrote her, I underwrote her and there was definitely room to play, but I saw her as somebody who was sort of very morally compromised and had pretty much left most of that behind and was really committed to this sort of like me mentality. And Renee came in and what I loved what Renee did with the character, and she did it, she created it. She found the vulnerability and the fear. And where it really comes through for me is the restaurant scene. Because when the restaurant scene starts between when Lucy forces her to go out with him, God, the age of sexual harassment, it almost sort of like rings true. But you think that she holds all the cards. When I was writing, I was thinking, oh, she has all the cards. But then he starts to pick her apart. And the way Renee played that scene is, as he started to like burrow deeper and deeper, and you suddenly realize what this was all about.
Where did you get the balls to even suggest something like this?
We're still talking.
No, there's nothing more to say.
You can leave.
Okay, look, you've done well, okay? And we pay you well, very well. We always have. If you like, I could get you an exclusive retainer. And that would be on top of your segment fees. I could maybe even get you a job at the station, starting as a production assistant, so that you could learn the business from the inside. That's where you said your interests lie.
Mm-hmm. You're not listening, Nina. I happen to know that you haven't stayed at one station for longer than 2 years at a time, and you're coming up on 2 years soon.
What I loved about what Renee did is you could see the vulnerability. You could see that when you reach a certain age and you don't have a pension and you don't have a job, it's a really scary place to be. Whatever judgment I'd written the character with fell apart the day we were shooting the scene where I suddenly realized this is somebody I can't. No, I don't judge people anyway, but I think I might have subconsciously been judging the character, like putting her in a category. And I took her out of that character because Renee brought this vulnerability. And you're looking at the character going, wow, she's at the lowest rated station. And she's been pinballing around. And she has no money saved probably. And who knows where it's going to go. And you can see the desperation. And she just brought this humanity to the character that I loved. And Jake brought a humanity to his character. Well, people also go, God, are you amazed by how dark Jake made the character? To me, that was not the amazing part of what Jake did. To me, it was the humanity that he found in the character. That he became so like us to a degree in many ways.
Yeah, but I found her frightening too, just because of how easily she...
How easily, yes, but we don't... See, the thing, I believe any one of us, the most moral of us in this room, under the wrong circumstances, I wouldn't want to say what we're capable of doing out of fear and out of desperation and out of confusion. And that to me is... I'm very interested in that circle. Roman Israel has to do with that. You think that I would never do that. I would never do that. And suddenly a series of events conspire and you go, I just did that. What the hell is that? I'm very interested. I believe we're also frail. We're also broken. We try to put on these fronts of like, oh, I'm together and I'm, look at me. I'm so together. It's like, we are all just quivering at any moment. We're all one phone call away from being on our knees. And that to me is interesting. We are. So to me, what's interesting is like how we carry ourselves, the brave way we carry ourselves through the world, in spite of that.
You've been watching A Conversation with Dan Gilroy on OnStory.
OnStory is part of a growing number of programs in Austin Film Festival's OnStory project, including the OnStory PBS series, now streaming online, the OnStory radio program and podcast in collaboration with Public Radio International, and the OnStory book series, available on Amazon. To find out more about OnStory and Austin Film Festival, visit onstory.tv or austinfilmfestival.com.